be most appropriate, we just start at the actual beginning, you know, whether or not you grew up a wrestling fan, how you broke in, how your training went, and then we'll cover some of your travels through the territories. And as we all know, you're going to land in Jim Crockett Promotions. So we'll cut it off there today, because I think most of our listeners probably became familiar with your work for the first time at Jim Crockett Promotions. And stay tuned next week. We'll have sort of the other bookend of the Jim Crockett story. We'll cover when you and Tully left JCP for the WWF. But for now, let's start at the beginning. Did you grow up a wrestling fan?
Well, I guess about 8 years old is my earliest recollection of seeing wrestling on TV. And it was where I grew up, Rome, Georgia. We got the Chattanooga, which I think was the Nick Goulas product back in those days. And I just remember Ed Caprol was the voice of that show. And man, I was hooked. As soon as I saw it, I was absolutely hooked. Even as a kid that small, I was just flabbergasted by it. It just had me mesmerized.
When did you, or did you ever have a chance to see wrestling from the New York territory? What was probably at the time the WWWF?
We didn't get that programming, as a kid, as I was growing up. Like I said, we got the Chattanooga, and then later on we got Georgia Championship Wrestling. I didn't have a chance to see that other than what I, you know, pick up a magazine at a store and, see it. It was kind of foreign to me, but it still, wrestling was wrestling. I loved all of it.
Well, these days there's a performance center and there's a variety of different ways to sort of break into the big time of professional wrestling. What was it like for you? You know, back then it was a much different industry, much harder to break into, very secretive, sort of underground. How did you manage to find a spot in the biz?
Well, you know, I was always like, even as a kid, you know, 8 years old, I would call my best friend, Bob Moss, who lived up on the hill, you know, in the wealthy section of the neighborhood. And I would say, you got to get down here, get down here, get down here. Hurry, I got to show you this. He'd hang up the phone and come running down. Now, I'm 8 years old. I got on my whitey tidy underwear. I got on a face mask toboggan, and I got a shoestring down in my underwear hiding by the door. When he busted in the door, I pulled out the shoestring, and I choked him out. So even then, I was a complete rogue of the neighborhood. So, you know, other guys, if they liked wrestling, they didn't admit to it. I admitted to it constantly. I loved it. So, you know, I just knew that everyone I talked to as I got older, they would just say, well, there's no way you can get in that. I mean, that's, we don't even know anybody, you know, and, being an athlete and my whole life, I'm thinking, God almighty, I wish I could do that. But I just knew it was a closed door. Even then, I mean, it wasn't even that you could meet anybody that had ever heard of meeting anybody that knew how to get in. It was that far detached.
So eventually you get that opportunity, but before you do, you mentioned a minute ago that you had sort of grown up an athlete. What sports did you play growing up?
Well, I wrestled and I played football. I played baseball up until I got to high school, which was my favorite sport, baseball. But once you got to high school and you played football, you either had to have a second sport that was either wrestling or track or basketball. Baseball didn't count. If you wanted to play baseball in the spring too, that would be a third sport, and that was just too much. So I dropped baseball. I was going to be a lineman and a linebacker playing football. So they decided, they being the coaching staff, that I would wrestle, and had some limited success, you know, as a amateur wrestler. Football, same thing. I did play with my senior year in high school at Eastern, Ray Donaldson, who went on to be the center for the University of Georgia and played on that national championship team. Ray and I were very good friends. And then he went on to enjoy about a 12 to 14 year NFL career, all pro with the Indianapolis Colts. So that was kind of my claim to fame as far as that went. But I was just good enough to be a pretty good player on my team, one of the better players on a high school team, but not good enough to go to college.
So after high school, you're probably trying to figure out, hey, where are we going to wind up with this thing? And somehow you wind up training with a guy named Ted Lipscomb. Is that right?
That's exactly right. And it, again, it was a freak thing. I went to the stadium every day after I get through lifting weights, and I'd go run a little bit, run, you know, mile, mile and a half, something, just to say I did. Was at the stadium that I played high school football, and also that was where the building sat that wrestling came to about every two or three Thursdays. Georgia Championship would run a live event there in Rome, and I would go. And this particular time, the timing was I was getting in my car to leave. Ted Allen was pulling in. I recognized him immediately off the television. And I just kind of hung out there till he got out of his car and got his bag out. I just kind of sauntered over to him very respectfully. I just said, you know, hello, my name's Marty Lundy. You know, I love what you do. I've been watching you for years and years since I was a kid. And God, what would somebody like me do to get in your business? And I should have seen it coming. In those days, a guy, a wrestler that was already in, would have said something along the lines of, you can't get in, and probably backhanded me. But Ted didn't. He was a gentleman. He just started asking me about myself. And I couldn't believe it. We were actually having a conversation. He then said, you know, if you got $500, I'll train you. I was floating by this particular time. I didn't believe him, but he gave me his phone number, said, give me a call tomorrow and we'll go forward. Well, I didn't sleep any that night, obviously. I called him the next day and he said, yep, we got to locate a ring somewhere and we'll get you started. Let me do some research. Well, he called me back a couple days. He said, I'm having a problem finding a ring. I told a friend of mine working out, I'm this close to getting something. They can't locate a ring. He said, let me talk to my dad, Jerry Hicks, who owned Jerry Hicks Furniture Store. Called me that night. He said, well, son, I'm gonna call this Ted Allen. He said, I didn't have a dad growing up, and I know you didn't either. I know you're at a cusp right now of needing somebody to help you with a break here. He says, so we're going to locate you a ring, and I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to put it up in the back of my furniture store so you'll have a place to train. You don't have to worry about paying rent and all that stuff. Wow. So Jerry Hicks was probably as important to me getting in the business as anybody else.